The 2020 NBA draft was so fun to predict. Leading up, we didn't have a really good idea of the order in which these top prospects were gonna come off the board like we do in most years. Now obviously this is way too early to redraft these top selections. We're not even 30 games into this season, but let's just put ourselves in the scenario where the 2020 draft is being redrafted tomorrow. Who's gonna go at the top? I think the top pick is going to have the most obvious change. We've seen enough. Not only should he have been the top pick, but he should have been the consensus top pick, similarly to what we saw with Zion Williamson. Since becoming the starter 6 games ago, LaMelo has proved his worth. He's averaged 22 points, 6 assists, and 5 rebounds, shooting 45% from the field and 49% from 3. If you've got the Timberwolves taking anyone else in a redraft based on the information we know right now, you're just wrong. The next one is the Golden State Warriors, and this one's kind of tough. It's going to come down to Anthony Edwards and James Wiseman. I don't think either one has really outperformed the other to this point, so I'm just going to have the Warriors stick with Wiseman. With LaMelo going number one, the Hornets have a decision to make here. I think there's definitely multiple people in the conversation, but I'm going to have them go with the original number one pick, Anthony Edwards. He got off to a really slow start, as we talked about in the last video, but he's getting better game after game. In the last 9 performances, he's averaged 17 points, shooting 40% from 3. The Bulls at 4 is interesting. Originally, they took Patrick Williams, who's been very solid, but with what we've seen out of Tyrese Halliburton, I've got to go with him. He's averaging 12 points and 5 assists, shooting 50% from the field and 46% from 3. He's great on both ends, and I really think he can ramp up the volume in the future, similar to what we saw with Shai Gilgeous-Alexander. Regardless of the fit, Halliburton has been too good. I'm fine if you want to have him even higher than this. Originally, the Cleveland Cavaliers decided to go with Isaac Okoro at number 5. I haven't had really any problems with him to this point, given the prospect he was coming in, but right now, with the opportunity to get Patrick Williams, who was originally off the board, they go ahead and snag him. I wasn't a big believer in him coming in, but he's really exceeded my expectations. I didn't think some of his wing skills were as good as they are. So far, he's averaged 10 points as a 40% three-point shooter. I think he'd be an amazing fit alongside Colin Sexton and Darius Garland. Going into the 2019 draft, there was no question that Zion Williamson was going to be the number one pick, regardless of what team had that selection. In this redraft, I don't think Zion has that same gap between the second best prospect, but he's still going number one. This season so far, he's averaging 24 points and 7 rebounds, shooting 60% from the field. I really think his performance would be getting more attention if the Pelicans roster wasn't in such a weird place that I really feel is hurting their success currently. The second overall pick is also going to say the same, and that's Ja Morant to the Memphis Grizzlies. He's a guy that a season ago won Rookie of the Year, and currently he's averaging 18 points and 8 assists a game. I do have some concerns about Morant, about his ability to stay healthy long term and his shooting to this point, but with what we know right now, I can't justify anyone going ahead of him. The Knicks at 3 is actually kind of tough. The last time I redrafted this selection, I had the Knicks going with Tyler Hero. And while that's still a fine selection, with what I've seen from RJ this year, I think his upside is too high for the Knicks to go away from him. In the last 15 games, he's averaged 18 points as a 41% three-point shooter. The 3-5 spot in this redraft is actually going to be really close, but here at 4, we've got the New Orleans Pelicans. Originally, we saw the Hawks trade up, but with the Pelicans knowing how these players would turn out, they don't let go of this selection and grab Tyler Hero. Hero is averaging 17 points, shooting 45% from the field and 35% from 3. He truly has the upside to be a 25-plus a game scorer, so the Pelicans don't pass up on the chance to pair him up with Zion and Brandon Ingram. That'd be a crazy young big 3. At 5, we've got the Cleveland Cavaliers, who originally took Darius Garland, a guy that was way down on redrafts after his rookie season, but with a great start to this year, I'm fine if you want to have them stick with their selection, but I've decided to have them go with DeAndre Hunter, just as it would be a more seamless fit. This season, he's averaging 17 points on great efficiency, and I still feel his upside is being severely underrated. With the number one pick in 2018, we originally saw the Phoenix Suns go with DeAndre Hunter, but I think we all know who goes here in a redraft, and that's going to be Luka Doncic, who in his third season is averaging 28 points, 9 assists, and 9 rebounds a game. Man, just imagine what this team would be doing right now with a Luka Booker backcourt. The Kings at 2 is interesting. There's just no way the Kings are going to go with their original selection, Marvin Bagley. And while the best player available is Trae Young, they already have their franchise point guard in De'Aaron Fox. This time last year, I would still have them going with Young regardless of the fit, but with how Fox is playing this season, I can't justify that. Now, the other options also happen to be point guards, So I'm just going to have them get the guy with the most positional flexibility in Shai Gilgeous-Alexander. He's just getting better and better. This year, he's averaging 23 points, 7 assists, and 6 rebounds, shooting 50% from the field and 38% from three. The Hawks luck out with the scenario of that previous selection and are able to get their guy in Trae Young. It's just this time, they're not making a trade with the Mavericks, so it's at 3 instead of 5. The Grizzlies originally went with Jaren Jackson Jr., who's still a great selection in a redraft, but with him out with injury and Colin Sexton playing amazing, I'm going to go with him. He's averaging 23 points and 4 assists, shooting 42% from 3. I was a Colin Sexton doubter for a very long time, but I've jumped ship on that stance. The Mavericks are not happy at the results of this redraft, not because the options available, but the fact that they're going to miss out on Luka Doncic. There's a lot of options here. You've got DeAndre Ayton, Jaren Jackson Jr., Michael Porter Jr., and Mikal Bridges. It's really close, but I'm going to have to go with Triple J based on the potential he showcased before going down last year. The number one pick in the 2017 draft was originally Markelle Fultz to the 76ers. Obviously, Fultz is not going here anymore, and the Celtics are no longer trading down from this spot. Now, the Celtics are going to walk away with the same player they ended up getting, just in a different spot. I'm not sure why we stopped talking about Tatum, but this guy is quickly climbing up the ladder of the best players in the league. He's averaging 27 points, 7 rebounds, and 4 assists, shooting 41% from 3 this year. The Lakers at 2 is another really, really tough one. Originally, we saw Lonzo Ball go here. That's not happening. This one's going to come down to Donovan Mitchell and Bam Adebayo. I'm really torn on this one, but for right now, I'm leaning slightly in the direction of Mitchell, considering the position this team was in at the time of the selection. Right now, he's leading Utah to one of the best records in the league, averaging 24 points and 5 assists, shooting 42% from 3. Real quick, I want to make it clear that the redrafts in this video from previous years won't affect the decision making for future years. Now this one again is tough due to fit. We've got the 76ers at 3, and I'm going to have them go with Bam Adebayo. This team would really have to figure out the spacing with a big 3 of Ben Simmons, Embiid, and Bam Adebayo, but man would this team be scary on the defensive end. In my opinion, the only other player that can compete for going here is De'Aaron Fox, but he's not going to be a perfect fit either. Here at 4, the Phoenix Suns originally took Josh Jackson. There's no question they are happy to remake that selection, and they're going to go with De'Aaron Fox, who's been on fire this season and really looks on pace to become one of the top point guards in the league very soon. With the 5th pick, we saw De'Aaron Fox go here, but he's off the board, so the decision is going to be between Lauri Markkanen and John Collins. It's close. Going into the season, I think I definitely would have said Collins, but with Markkanen averaging 19 points, shooting 51% from the field, and 40% from 3 to start this year, I've got to go with him. Every time I redrafted 2016, I never changed the player that went number 1, but that's not the case today. We all know Ben Simmons is great, but his scoring just hasn't progressed enough for him to hold on to this spot. For me, it's really going to come down to Jaylen Brown or Brandon Ingram. Statistically, Brown has been performing better, but his efficiency has just been a little too good to maintain. I think Brandon Ingram brings more game-changing ability to the table, so I'm going to go with him. I think there's a lot of scenarios across the league where Ingram would be averaging around 30 points a game. The Lakers are going to go with Jaylen Brown. I really love what he can bring to the table. This is the guy that first proved himself as a 3-and-D guy, but is now an offensive powerhouse, averaging 27 points, shooting 52% from the field, and 43% from 3. His ability at all 3 levels gives me confidence he's going to be a very big problem for a very long time. The Celtics are now going to get Ben Simmons, who has fallen down the board. I'm fine if you like Simmons higher than this, but this is where I have him for now. He's one of the top defensive players in the league right now, while averaging 14 points, 8 rebounds, and 8 assists a game. At 4, we originally saw the Suns go with Dragan Bender. That is not happening this time around, and they're going to go with Domantas Sabonis. This one was a toss-up between him and Siakam, but for right now, I'm giving him the slightest edge. This season, he's averaging 21 points, 12 rebounds, and 5 assists, shooting 53% from the field, and 37% from 3. With the Suns going with Sabonis, the Timberwolves take Siakam, who hasn't really progressed like we thought he would when he started the season on fire a year ago, but the Timberwolves are much happier with this outcome as they originally took Chris Dunn.